الطير أغناها وقد جابت سماها. كم مرة قد ضقت من عظم البلاء، بشر وشيطان يحاصرني أبا. كم مرة قد أظلم الدرب.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، ما بعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today's video will be very, very important, and I think it's going to be a very powerful video that I have no doubt in my mind that people would feel sick to their stomach after when I present all the evidences and all the information, and want to contextualize all the aqwal of the Salaf, the statements of the Salaf in relation to tabdi', you would see exactly how deceptive the cult of Madaakhilah and their likes are. Now, as we did a video regarding chain takfir, okay, and we obviously exposed the reality of the early da'wah to Najdiyah, you know, we call them takfiris. Now, these individuals, the Madaakhilah and their likes, we call them tabdi'i. So they're two sides of the same coin. Okay, they are two sides of the same coin. So let's put that out there, that we have no doubt in our minds that the same way that we condemn and expose the takfiris, you tabdi'i are no different to them. Okay, so that's the reality. That is the reality of your cult. And we are here today to expose your deep hatred for Ahlul Sunnah. Meaning that you guys feel that you and your cult are the only group that are upon the Sunnah and everyone else is upon misguidance. Now, in relation to the statements I'm going to bring, okay? Now, outwardly, what they bring in relation to the statements of the Salaf surrounding them making tabdi' is true, okay? It's generally true. What they bring, okay? And the usul and the qawa'id is generally correct as well, but the way they apply it is very, very sinister, very, very sinister and misplaced, because in essence they've abused the statements of the Salaf to promote their toxic and filthy methodology, and that's fact. Okay, that is fact. Now, the way this takfiris, okay, the way the takfiriyun abuse takfir, they abuse it. So they bring statements which is generally true, but the application of it is very sinister, and they abuse the statements of the Imams and they apply takfir rashly. So likewise, the Madaakhilah and their likes apply tabdi' in the same manner. Now, as we call the takfiris, takfiriyun or takfiri, likewise these groups or these individuals, khasatan al-Madaakhilah, are tabdi'i. Now what I say to them, to the cult of the Madaakhilah, is what Ali radiallahu anhu said to the Khawarij. And when the Khawarij were accusing Ali radiallahu anhu of being a kafir for agreeing the arbitration with Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, they were chanting a slogan which was La hukm illa lillah, that no judgment apart from Allah's judgment. Now that statement is true, no doubt. Alaysa Allahu bi ahkamil hakimin, that isn't Allah the best of the judges. Okay, so Ali radiallahu anhu, when he heard their slogans and their chants, what did he respond back with? The statement is true, no one's going to deny that statement. But he said, Qalimatul haq urid biha batil. The statement and the words are true, but what they want from it is falsehood. Exactly the same way with the Madaakhilah and the Tabdi'i. What they're saying is true from the statements of the Salaf, but what they want from it is falsehood. Okay, so let's just put that out there. And one thing I have to add as well, these statements from the Salaf, bearing in mind, it's not the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The way they take these statements is as if the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said it. So whilst we acknowledge that this, that the Salaf al-Saleh are the best of generations, okay, one cannot take their words as if the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said it. They are men. This video would have plenty of clips from the Madaakhilah and their likes themselves, showing you how extreme and how they've applied statements of tabdi' and have declared people mubtadi'ah harshly and unjustly. And you hear this from their own mouths. So what we'll do is, let's give you a brief example or a taster of certain heads of the Madaakhilah issue blanket tabdi' unjustly. Okay, so let's have a listen.
After 14 centuries of deviation that has spread and polluted the Ummah of Muhammad, Ahlul Sunnah have become small in number. Smaller and smaller and smaller. And the people of Bid'ah, they are great in number. And they are the ones who make us seem as if we are the ones who have gone to excesses and exaggeration. I could fill many volumes of how the early scholars, the Sahaba and those who came after them, how they would treat the people of Bid'ah. How they would banish them, boycott them, speak ill of them, humiliate them, even to the point of sending them to execution. Whether it be Abu Usama, Abdul Rahim Green, Bilal Phillips, Yasir Qadi, Saeed Raghi, Abu Usama al-Dhahabi. Doesn't bother us, Suhaib Hassan, Usama Hassan. Ahlul Sunnah are not harmed by those betrayers, the Mukhaddiloon, Ahlul Takhdeel, those who betray the deen of Allah, stand at the doors of Jahannam, selling their religion for a pittance. All of them bid'ah, upon bid'ah and misguidance.
So as you've just heard, statements from the heads of the Madaakhilah in the West, those donkeys in Birmingham, the real donkeys. So you see how harsh, how disrespectful, how they promote these narrations and these statements by accusing Muslims of being misguided, innovators, etc. It's easy on the tongue, isn't it? Easy on the tongue. So what we're going to do now is we're going to present a sample of certain statements that they promote or they use to justify their extreme tabdi'. And we're going to go into the books, and what we're going to do is we're going to contextualize these statements. We're going to give you the context of these statements. Who were the Salaf referring to? Okay? Rather than these ignoramus that have no formal education as such, and they've been given titles such as Sheikh and Ustad. You know, astaghfirullah al-azim. So let's start off. So these are the general statements, and then what we're going to do is, in the same chapter, we're going to show you who these quotes were referring to, okay? In the same chapter. So we're going to bring statements from the Salaf, okay, when they talk about tabdi' and this person's a mubtadi', etc., etc., and don't sit with such and such. And we're going to contextualize these statements, and we're going to give you its true context that the Madaakhilah never do, because they half-bake their quotes, they use every technicality in the book, and today, bro Hajji is going to give you the true context. Bro Hajji is going to relate to you what the Salaf intended, rather than these ignoramuses that have no clue and promote a cult. In essence, it's a cult. So let's get to it. We got the book here, Al-Ibana. Okay, Al-Ibana is written by Ibn Battah. This is Al-Ibana Al-Kubra. Okay, this is Al-Ibana Al-Sughra. This is Al-Ibana Al-Kubra. So as you can see on screen, you know, when people shake when they hear that. As you can see on screen, you've got the chapter. And the chapter is a warning from associating with the people who sicken the hearts and corrupt the iman. Okay, so look at the title. The title is a severe warning to those or associating with the people who sicken the hearts and corrupt the iman. Okay, so this is the chapter we're going to look into. So what we'll do is we'll give you a few statements that the Madaakhilah generally use. And then in the same chapter, we're going to give you the context. So these are general statements I'm going to give you. And they use these statements to apply on Muslims, to apply on Ahl Sunnah. And then afterwards, we're going to show you who the Salaf were referring to. Who were they talking about? Okay? So, as you can see on screen, so we got a statement here. Okay? So as you can see on screen, you got a statement from Abu Qilaba. And he said, okay, regarding the people of desires, he said, Abu Qilaba said, do not sit with the people of Ahwa. Now the people of Ahwa are the people of desires. For verily I do not feel safe that they will immerse you in their misguidance or confuse you in that which you already know. So as you can see, okay, from that particular statement, it's a general statement, isn't it? Don't sit with the people of desires. So the people of desires, generally speaking, could mean anyone, couldn't it? Depending on who you feel is a people of desires. So that statement doesn't really give you the context, does it? But they use these statements. So, oh, you see, the Salaf said, don't sit with the people of desires. But we're going to give you more. And then afterwards, we're going to give you the proper context. Next, okay? As you can see on screen, this is from Al-Hasan al-Basri. And he says, لَا تُجَالِسُ أَحْلِ الْأَحْوَى. Do not sit with the people of desires. So you see again, general statement, do not sit with the people of desires. فَإِنَّ مُجَالَسَتَهُمْ مُمَرِّدَةٌ لِلْقُلُوبِ مُمَرِّدَةٌ لِلْقُلُوبِ. So do not sit with the people of desires, for verily their gatherings are a sickness for the heart. Okay? So أَحْلِ الْأَحْوَى again, a general statement. Okay? It's a general statement. And once again, we got another statement. Okay? And this is number 395. Okay? And this is from Muhammad bin Sirin. Okay? Muhammad bin Sirin said, and this is obviously from Al-Hasan al-Basri and Muhammad bin Sirin. He said, كان الحسن ومحمد يقولان. Okay? They both said. And what did they say? They said, لا تجالس أصحاب الأحواء. Do not sit with the people of desires. ولا تجادلهم. Do not, okay, listen to them. Okay, do not argue with them, rather. Do not argue with them. وَلَا تَسْمَعُوا مِنْهُمْ. And do not listen to any narrations from them. So again, general. Okay, don't sit with them. Don't argue with them. And don't listen to them. General statement from Al-Hasan al-Basri and Muhammad bin Sirin. Okay, from the Salaf. So now, we got another statement, 398. And it states, Ibn Battah, obviously under 398, states that two men from Ahl al-Ahwa, so again, general, Ahl al-Ahwa, the people of desires, came to Muhammad bin Sirin and said, Oh Abu Bakr, we wish to talk to you about some matters. Okay? And he replied, no. Okay? He replied, no. And this is Al-Hasan. Is it Hasan al-Basri? No, Muhammad bin Sirin. Okay. So, as you can see, okay, general statements thus far. So, in essence, you could say, like, all right then. So, yeah, the Salaf did say, you know, don't sit with the people of desires. So when the Madaakhilah say, don't sit with the people of desires, why have they said wrong? You understand? And they use these statements to back it up. So what we'll do now is, we'll present more videos. Okay, we'll present more videos to show you their rashness and their extremism in Tabdi'. So let's listen to some more.
Because now, winter is coming. Those conferences are back. Every year, a handful disappear. Take a corner of the masjid gone. Every year. Ma'asalama, go. You don't want the truth? Go. They say, oh, we're going up the road because Sheikh Fulan is coming. Oh, we're going down to Luton because Sheikh Fulan is coming. Oh, we're going to Brixton because Sheikh Fulan is coming. So you will gather with Ahlul Bid'ah. And you will sit with the Ahlul Bid'ah. And you will follow the mistakes. And claim that Sheikh Fulan and Sheikh Fulan, as Sheikh Al-Fawzan mentions, that every time they go astray, what do they bring to you? Fulan from the Sheikh said. Fulan from the Sheikh said. Sheikh Al-Fawzan said this is nothing but hawa. Hawa. Desires. You leave the sunnah. Because Fulan said and Fulan said and Fulan said.
Rabi said. Al-Albani said. Bin Baz said. Muqbil said. This is our manhaj. This is our manhaj, ya ikhwan. No apologies for that. What's your manhaj said? Al-Albani said, Bin Baz said, Muqbil said, this is our manhaj. This is our manhaj, ya ikhwan. No apologies for that. What's your manhaj?
This video will include so much clips of this cult and the extremism. So they're no different to the takfiris. Like we call them takfiris, these guys are tabdi'i. Okay, same thing, two sides of the same coin. Now what we're going to do is we're going to contextualize these statements. And we're going to bring statements from Al-Ibana, Al-La'ika'i's book, Imam Al-Bukhari's Khalq al-Fa'al al-Ibad, and we're going to break Ibn Taymiyyah's statements to show you when the Salaf mentioned Ahl al-Ahwa, the people of desires, the people of misguidance, who they were actually talking about. As you could see on screen, we got the book, Al-Istighathatu, Fir Rad al Bakri. Okay? And as you can see on screen, Ibn Taymiyyah mentions, okay, Ibn Taymiyyah mentions, and he says, وَكَذَلِكَ الرَّافِضَ ابْتَدَعُوا تَفْدِيلَ عَلِي ala thalatha. He says that the Rafida innovated, okay, that Ali is better than the three. Okay, so the Rafida innovated that Ali is better than the three. And they preferred Imama, okay, and they called to Isma, meaning Ali radiallahu anhu is infallible. Now listen to this, as you can see, it says, وَكَذَلِكَ الْجَحْمِيَّةِ Jahmiyyah innovated, okay, innovated, denying the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, this nafi here, this denying, is bid'at mukaffara. This is bid'ah mukaffara. This is bid'ah that you can make takfira. Because to deny the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kufr. Okay? It's not ta'weel, because that's an interpretation. They believe in it, but they gave it a figurative interpretation. This is nafi. This is denying it. They say, no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not rise above his throne. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have hands. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not descend. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have the ability to listen and hear. They believe this. Okay? The Jahmiyyah. And then he mentions that they negated the sifat of Allah and his actions and his names, etc. And they made apparent their saying. Okay? Listen to this. And then he also said Ibn Taymiyyah, rahmatullah alayh, and they made takfir on those who did not agree with them. So they made takfir as well. So they innovated, okay, not believing in the sifat. And they didn't believe in Allah's names and attributes. They denied it completely. Now this bid'ah is mukaffara, okay? It's the one. It's a bid'ah that takes you out of the fold of Islam. Let's now get into it even further to contextualize these statements, okay? And then we're going to get to what Ibn Taymiyyah says. Then he says, وَكَذَلِكَ الْقَدَرِيَّةِ ابتدعت التقديب بالقدر. That the Qadariya were the ones that innovated denying the Qadr. Now, denying the Qadr is kufr akbar. Is a bid'ah mukaffara. It's a bid'ah that negates your Islam. Okay? Now, this is obviously the Qadariya generally, they were extremism. There were other not so severe from the Qadariya. But Ibn Taymiyyah also mentions that they denied also the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? And then Ibn Taymiyyah further go on to say that they made takfir on those who opposed them. So on top of that, if you oppose them on this, they made takfir of you. Okay? So they were upon batil. Okay? But yet they made takfir of you if you didn't believe them. Strange. Then he says, وَكَذَلِكَ الْحُلُولِيَّ وَمُعَطِّلَةِ Then the Hululiyyah, who believe Allah dwells inside his creation. So Ibn Taymiyyah is explaining all these sects that innovated. Okay? That innovated. And they believed that whoever believes in this is fat, disbelieves whoever opposes them. And then he mentions, obviously, various things. Then Ibn Taymiyyah goes into other groups as well. And he says, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ لَيْسَ كَلَامُهُ إِلَّا مَعْنَى وَاحِدٌ قَائِمًا بِذَاتِهِ وَمَعْنَى التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ وَالْقُرْآنِ وَاحِدٌ وَالْقُرْآنِ الْعَزِيزِ لَيْسَ هُوَ كَلَامُهُ بَلْ كَلَامُ الْجِبْرَائِيلِ أَوْ غَيْرِهِ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يُكَفِّرْ مَنْ خَالَفُ So this group believed, okay, that the Quran wasn't the speech and the other books weren't the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it was the speech of Jibreel and others. So there were many, many weird sects, and they also made takfir if you oppose them as well. So Allahu musta'an. Then Ibn Taymiyyah goes into further details. Now we don't want to go into the whole passage, but right at the end, which is very important, let's see what Ibn Taymiyyah says. So after explaining all of these batil sects that came, Ibn Taymiyyah says, فَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ أَحْلِ السُنَّةِ هُمْ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ And he says that the believers from Ahl Sunnah, they fight for in Allah's way. Whoever fights them, meaning the Muslims, يُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ الطَّاغُوتِ And those who fight, the Muslims fight for the sake of Taghut, false gods, etc. And then he says, listen to this, قَصَّدِّقْ مَا أَحْلِ الرِّدَّةِ Like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who fought the people of the apostates. Okay? Then he says, Ka'ali ibn Abi Talib, ma'al khawarij, khawarij al-mariqin, wa ma'al ghulat wa sabi'iyya. That Ali radiallahu anhu, who fought the khawarij, and those from the extremism from the sabi'iyya. And their deeds, meaning the believers, were sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he agreed with the sunnah. Then it says, the deeds of those who oppose them are not sincere and are not correct. Okay? بَلْ بِدْعَ وَإِتَّبَعَ الْحَوَى Listen to this. And those who oppose them. So Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned the Hululiyyah, the Qadariyyah, the Jahmiyyah, the Rafida, and various other batil sects and said they innovated. And then Ibn Taymiyyah ends off by saying, those who oppose them, they're not sincere, they're not correct, but in fact they are bid'ah and they follow their desires. And look what Ibn Taymiyyah ends off by saying, وَلِهَادَ يُسَمُّونَ أَحْلِ الْبِدْعَةِ وَأَحْلِ الْأَحْوَىٰ. And this is the reason why they were called the people of bid'ah and the people of desires. You see? You know, when you contextualize these statements from the Salaf, when they meant the people of desires, the people of desires, the people of desires, the people of bid'ah, they meant the Jahmiya, the Qadariya, the Mu'tazila, the one who believed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indwells in his creation. This is what Ibn Taymiyyah says. This is why they were called the people of bid'ah and the people of desires. So when you grab those statements from the Salaf, who were they talking about? They were talking about the essence of these groups were not from Ahli Sunnah. So here you go, my dear brothers and sisters. All of these statements from the Salaf that I quoted from a general perspective, I'm going to go into the details now when they specifically mentioned who they were. Because Ibn Taymiyyah confirmed. So he started off with the Rafida. Then he went to the Jahmiyyah or the Qadariyyah. Then he went to the Jahmiyyah. Then he went to the Hululiyyah. Then he went to those groups that believed in that the Quran wasn't the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they innovated and they innovated. And at the end, after explaining everything, Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhi said, this is why they were called the people of bid'ah and desires. Okay? So when you hear those videos that you heard, they're people of desires, they're people of desires. You see where they misapply it or misplace it. Do you understand what I'm saying? So now let's go into the books and now show you who the Salaf were talking about now. Because I gave you the general statements, okay, from the Salaf. Now let's go into the details. From the same chapter. Do you remember the chapter as you can see on screen? A warning from associating with the people who sicken the hearts and corrupt the iman. Now all those, the explanation that Ibn Taymiyyah gave about all those sects that innovated, of course they sicken the hearts. Look what they believed in. They believed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not have any names and attributes. They denied Qadr, etc, etc. So obviously, when the Salaf were mentioning, don't sit next to them, who were they talking about? Who were they talking about, my friends? Well, not the Madaakhilah. Wouldn't keep you as friends, mate. If anything, I wouldn't want to tabdi' on you because I'm not mujtahid. Let's leave it as it is. Okay, so let's start off now in bringing the quotes from the same chapter that I quoted from. As you can see on screen, okay, number 400. Okay, number 400. Tawus. Okay, it states that kana tawus jalisan faja'a rajul min al mu'tazila faja'ala yatakallam. So looks, listen now. Ibn Battah quotes a narration and he says that tawus was sitting and a man came from the mu'tazila and started to speak in the same chapter. So where was he from? He was from the mu'tazila. So Tawus put his fingers in his ear, okay? And he told his son, put your finger in your ear severely and do not listen to their statements. Because, okay, because what? يَعْنِي أَنَّ الْقَلْبُ دَعِيفٌ. Because the heart is weak. So you see, in the same chapter, after quoting, you know, the general statements, don't sit by the people of desire, don't sit by the people of misguidance, Tawus, when he met the Mu'tazila who wanted to speak to him, he put his finger in his ear. Okay? So, the Mu'tazila were from Ahl al-Bid'ah. And many of the Salaf, which we're going to get to, made takfir of the Mu'tazila, meaning their creed, because they believed the Quran was makhluk. Okay? So let's carry on. So the gist of it is, Tawus didn't allow them to sit next to him. And he said, if you sit, we will get up. Okay? So you see, the first narration, a man came from the Mu'tazila. And then the next narration, he mentions a man for the people of desires. So who were these people of desires? The Mu'tazila, from in this narration. Next, okay. Now let's go to, we're going to go back to Ibana later. Okay, we're going to go back to Ibana later. The people of desires are those who innovated major bid'ah that can lead to disbelief. Okay, so let's go back to Al-Ibana. As you can see on screen, okay, as you can see on screen, under narration 408, listen to this. He said, a man came to Anas bin Malik. Okay? A man came to Anas bin Malik. And I was with him. So, and he said to me, Ya Aba Hamza, I met a people who disbelieved in the Shafa'ah. Disbelieved in the Shafa'ah. they denied the shafa'ah, meaning the intercession of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam on the Day of Judgment. And what else did they deny? They denied the punishment in the grave. So see the chapter heading at the start about those who sicken the hearts. This people of desires, etc., that was general, was referring to major innovated groups, and they denied the shafa'ah, and they denied the punishment in the grave. And look what Anas bin Malik said. He said, those people are liars. Do not sit with them. So you notice when you see the Madaakhilah said, do not sit with Ahlul Bid'ah. Do not sit with Ahlul Bid'ah.
So you will gather with Ahlul Bid'ah. And you will sit with the Ahlul Bid'ah.
You notice that these statements, if you contextualize these statements, these were the Ahlul Bid'ah Haqiqiyah. These were the original Ahlul Bid'ah who were believing in stuff which can lead to disbelief. So no doubt when the Salaf said, do not sit next to them, it made sense, didn't it? So you're applying these statements to who? To Muslims, to Sunni Muslims. Because you go, the Salaf said, don't sit next to the people of desires. But who were they talking about, mate? They were talking about people who disbelieved in the Shafa'ah. Do you find anyone, you know, from your little cronies, from the four wizards that you have in your cult? If we don't agree with Shaykh al-Rabi'ah, we don't accept Ubayd al-Jabri and, you know, the three, four wizards that you've got in your cult, then what? We're people of desires. But if you read the statements of the Salaf, it's got nothing to do with these examples that you give. These individuals were disbelieving in the Shafa'ah. Are you comparing us to them? Are you comparing us to those who disbelieved in the Shafa'ah and Adhab al-Qabr? And then when Anas bin Malik said to Abdullah al-Rumah, he said, those people are liars, do not sit next to them. Are you equating us with them? Are you equating us with them? Get a break. So let's listen to some more examples to show you how much liars these guys are.
This individual, Tahir Wyatt. Remember this about Tahir Wyatt. Tahir Wyatt is that individual whose tongue is moist and dripping wet with his rhetoric against the Salafis. I've heard him speak with my own two ears. Barakhuna al-Fadil Abu Khatija. Hafidahullah. With my own two ears. I've heard him speak about Abul Hasan Malik. Hafidahullah. Both of them, my dear brothers. And speaking against them is like speaking against me. Moist. Speaking out against Ahlul Sunnah. Against Abu Hakim Bilal Davis. What does Sheikh Rabia say about Tahir Wyatt? Sheikh Rabia Hafidahullah. He said, and I'm paraphrasing, that I heard he speaks out against the Salafis. And he heard correctly, Hafidahullah. But then when we asked him to clarify his position regarding Abul Hasan al-Ma'rabi and Ali Hasan al-Halabi, he refused to do so. What does this mean? What does this mean? What does this mean? He is with them. مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. He has love for them. You speak against the Salafis, I
speaking ill of him because of his deen, then look to see what he is saying. If he is from Ahlul Bid'ah, then we don't listen to him. Why? Because Muhammad ibn Sirin, rahimahullah ta'ala, what did he say? That before the fitna began, we never used to ask the people. We never used to ask the people about the narrations. But when the fitna began, meaning of the Khawarij, when the fitna began, then we used to say to the people, name us your men. If they were from Ahlul Sunnah, then we accepted from them. And if they were from Ahlul Bid'ah, then we rejected it.
So that's the criterion. The one who's bringing the proof, the one who's talking to you, so-called proof, or the one who's trying to make this tahdhir and this warning, is he from Ahlul Sunnah or is he from Ahlul Bid'ah? Ahlul Shubahat, Ahlul Hawa, Hizbi, with the Hizbis, walks with them, talks with them, mixes with them, prays with them, relaxes with them, eats with them, drinks with them, keeps company with them. And then he makes an attack against our brother Abu Hakim. As a mithal. Or our brother Hassan al-Somali. Or our brother Abu Iyad.
Okay, so as you can see on screen, okay, we got a narration here. And it basically mentions that Abu Idris al-Khawlani, he said that Abu Jamila, okay, he does not believe in the Qadr. And what does he say? Do not sit with him. Do not sit with him. Why don't you sit with him? Because he disbelieved in what? The Qadr. Okay? Hence why the Salaf, when they mentioned those statements and you contextualize them, they were from Ahl al-Bid'ah. The real Ahl al-Bid'ah who believed in Bid'ah Mukaffara that could lead you into disbelief. So naturally so. It's common sense, don't you think, that if I heard of someone just down the road from me now, down the road from me, and some brother came up to me and said, you know what, that brother doesn't believe in the Qadr. No doubt, without any hesitation, I said, you know what, don't sit next to this guy. Don't even speak to him. Because he is from Ahl al-Bid'ah. Anyone, according to you guys, don't agree with Sheikh al-Rabi' or anyone else that's in your little cult. He's a person of desires. He's a person of bid'ah. But you don't understand the context of the statement of the Salafs. And I'm just getting started. We're going to go to other books as well. Don't worry about it. Let's carry on. Number 413. Okay. So, as you can see on screen again, we got a narration and an athar. Okay. And this is narrated by Ismail ibn Aliyah. Qala, that Sa'id ibn Jubair. Okay. Sa'id ibn Jubair said, do not sit with Talqan or Talaqan, ya'ni, because he is a murji. You see, the statements, the general statements we presented at the start, that said, do not sit with people of desires, Qadariya, Jahmiya, Mu'tazila, the two that I mentioned after, to Tawus. And now we got Sa'id ibn Jubair. And he said, don't sit next to this guy, because why? He's a murji. So now let's contextualize these statements even more. The statements from the Salaf, which the Madkhalis and the Madaakhilah have abused, more notably their Sheikh al-Rabi'. So let's just put the quotes on screen. So as you can see, again, let's contextualize these statements. It states that when Sufyan al-Thawri entered Basra, okay? So when he entered Basra, he started to look at the affair of al-Rabi'. Oh, again, is that right? Have I read it right? Yandur ila amr Rabi'. Okay, so into the affair of al-Rabi' ibn al-Subayh, and he stationed with the people. So he asked, what is his creed? They replied, his creed is not except the Sunnah. So he asked, who are his associates? They said, they are the people who deny Qadr, meaning they are Ahlul Qadr. So he then responded by saying, what did he say? Qala huwa qadari, meaning he is from the Qadaris. So when you contextualize these statements, he was talking about the associates, okay, of those who were with Al-Qadariya. So you're implying that if a Sunni, just say who happens to be from the Madaakhilah, and he just sits next to a Sunni brother of his, and he could be of a different, you know, group, because he sat next to him, you're applying this hukam. Because Sufyan al-Thawri said, do not sit next to, or who, those are those of his associates are Qadari. So are you saying that the Qadaris are the same as, just say, the Ikhwanis? Are you putting that comparison out there that there's no difference? So then he says, okay, that Ibn Battah said, may Allah's mercy be upon Sufyan al-Thawri. Indeed, he spoke with wisdom and spoke the truth. He spoke with knowledge, which is in agreement with his book and the Sunnah, and spoken in accordance what is necessitated by wisdom. perceived with the eyes and known to the people of inside education. Now, let's go into further quotes, as you can see on screen. Fudail ibn Ayyad, okay? Fudail ibn Ayyad said that man jalasa ma' sahib al-bid'ah, okay? Whoever sits with the person of bid'ah does not attain any wisdom, okay? Sit next to the people of bid'ah. So who are these people of bid'ah, may I ask? Qadariya, Mu'tazila, Jahmiya, Hululiya, all of these misguided sects, which Ibn Taymiyyah said, that's why they were called Ahl al-Bid'ah wal Ahl al-Ahwa. So they were Ahl al-Bid'ah from the Asl. They were from Ahl al-Bid'ah. They were from Ahl al-Sunnah. And those who sat next to them, obviously they were sitting next to dangerous groups who were, in essence, some of the Salaf even accused them of being kuffar, and we'll even quote that from other books. So don't worry, we're just getting started. Then also, Fudail ibn Ayyad said, whoever loves the person of bid'ah, Allah would make his deeds worthless and would remove the light of Islam from his heart. Again, this is, remember, you bear in mind that this is not a statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just remember that. That's a statement of Fudail ibn Ayyad. Now, it's possibly true that a person who sits near the person of bid'ah, Allah will, make his deeds worthless. Is that a statement from the Prophet? Remember that. So don't use these statements as if it's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talking. This is his opinion. And again, he may potentially be right. But you can't use this to enforce it. Because I could quite clearly say I don't agree with it. Okay. And then Fudail ibn Ayyad also said, La tajlisu ma'a sahib al-bid'ah. Do not sit next to the person of bid'ah. فَإِنِّي أَخَافَ أَن تَنْزِلَ عَلَيْكَ اللَّعْنَةِ He said, do not sit with the person of bid'ah, for indeed I fear that curses will come upon you. Okay, no. إِنَّ أَخَافَ So he fears. So remember, as much as we highly respect the Salaf, عَلَى رَاسِبُ الْعَيْنِ on top of our heads, the Imams of the Salaf, it's not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who's saying this. Just bear that in mind. Okay, and the way you bully people and the way you intimidate people, especially the awam, that's what's shocking. You're talking to the awam, are you with this sheikh? Do you listen to this sheikh? You know, relax. You understand? We're not Qadaris, we're not Mu'tazila, we're not Mu'tazilis, we're not Jahmi, we're not from the Jahmis. Relax, because these statements have a context. So get it through your thick skull that your game is over, mate. That your game is over. We're just getting started. I'm only quoting from Al-Ibana. Those statements, those general statements that you use. Mate, you're getting thrown. You're getting blown out the water, mate. Because now we're contextualizing these statements to show the audience and the world, look how you've abused them. You understand? Let's carry on. I have not finished. Okay. As Sufyan al-Thawri says, okay, whoever listens to an innovator, okay, has left the protection of Allah and is entrusted with innovation. Okay? This is what Sufyan al-Thawri said. Okay? Now, who were the people of innovation at that time? So when the Salaf were mentioning these statements, are you saying the level of bid'ah and the degree of bid'ah for those who you hold today of sahib al-bid'ah and do not sit next to them and do not, you know, even look at them? You know what I mean? Are you actually saying that we're, because obviously you call everyone and everyone sahib al-bid'ah, we are as bad as the Jahmiyyah and the Mu'tazila and the Qadariyyah and the Mu'attila and the Hululiyyah? major sects which were innovation, were innovators and major innovations. But let's carry on. Okay, 455. Okay. So one of the students of Uza'i said that I heard Uza'i who was asked about the Qadariya, and he said, "Do not sit with them." So you see those general statements at the start. Don't sit with them. Don't sit with Ahl al-Bid'ah, Ahl al-Ahwa. Qadariya. So Uza'i says, don't sit next to who? Al-Qadariya. Who are the Qadariya? The ones who denied Allah's Qadr, the predestination, and also denied Allah's will. These are the ones that just said, come on, be fair. Would you, if you knew of a Qadari right now, would you not warn people not to sit next to that Qadari? Because the bid'ah that he is upon is a bid'ah mukaffara. It can lead you to disbelief. But no. Don't sit next to the Ikhwanis, because the Qadari and the Ikhwanis are no different, aren't they? You understand what I mean? The Jahmiya and the Qadariya, I mean the Jahmiya and the Ikhwani are no different. Do you know what I mean? They're on the same degree. Astaghfirullah. I'm not an Ikhwani, just to get it through your thick skull. You get it? And on top of that as well, I've been hearing through the grapevine that people say, oh, well, why don't Hajji refute the Diobandis? What? Because he's a clandestine Diobandi. Hold on, yeah. I'm telling you, I'm not a Diobandi. And even then, why don't Hajji refute the Ikhwanis? Why don't Hajji refute the Brelwiya? Listen, you've got no right to dictate to me who I refute and who I don't refute. If anything, I decide who I want to refute and who I don't want to refute. You understand what I mean? And let me clear the record. I'm not a Diobandi. So unless you're thick and you can't get it through your thick skull, and because you can't refute my content and you can't refute the evidences I bring, then you're behaving like, you know, little boys who have just gone out their nappies and say, oh, well, why don't you refute the Diobandis? Why don't you refute X, Y, and Z? Ridiculous. Like, you know, grow a pair. You understand? Grow a pair. All right. Now, we got Ibn Aun. Ibn Aun said that whoever sits next to or whoever sits with Ahlul Bid'ah is more severe to us and more worse to us than Ahlul Bid'ah themselves. Okay, so this is what Ibn Aun says. But which Ahlul Bid'ah? Again, which Ahlul Bid'ah we're talking about? So what we'll do, okay, I've finished the book Al-Ibana. Okay, there's many other quotes in here, the whole chapter regarding warning with and associating with those who sicken the heart. There's plenty more, but you can quite clearly see when you contextualize all of these statements, they're referring to the worst of the Ahlul Bid'ah, and quite clearly the Madaakhilah, Spubs, Troid, and their likes, DUS Da'wah, don't understand what they're quoting. It's truly deceptive, and there's malice behind it, and we now have shown you from Al-Ibana quite clearly who the Salaf were talking about. Who were they referring to? Which groups from Ahlul Bid'ah? What were their beliefs, etc. But see how they abuse them by saying, oh, but the Salaf said this. But the Salaf said this, but they don't contextualize it. And what was the statement that I used at the start? When the Khawarij, when the arbitration happened between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, and when Ali radiallahu anhu agreed to an arbitration between the army of Sham and the army of Iraq, meaning Ali radiallahu anhu, the Khawarij who split from the group started chanting the slogan, La hukm illa lillah, La hukm illa lillah, no judgment but Allah's judgment. So when Ali radiallahu anhu heard their slogans, what did he respond by saying? Because they're not saying anything wrong. He ended up saying, Kalimatul haq uri biha batil. That the statement of truth, but what they want from it is misguidance. Exactly the same. So I'm not saying you're from the Khawarij because I'm not like you. You understand what I mean? I'm not like you. So let's go into La'ikai's book now and contextualize the statements from La'ikai's book. So as you can see on screen, okay, we've got statement from Muhammad bin Sirin. So basically Muhammad bin Sirin, okay, said that if لو خرج الدجال, okay, that if the Dajjal was to emerge and I see him, okay, and if you see him, you would see those who follow him from the Ahl al-Ahwa, okay, from the people of desires. So to the Madaakhilah, are you saying now, because we know obviously Muhammad bin Sirin is talking about, once again, let's repeat it constantly, Al-Qadariya, Al-Jahmiya, Al-Hululiya, Al-Mu'tazila, all these misguided sects. So when Ibn Sirin, or Muhammad bin Sirin said, if the Dajjal was to emerge, you would see those who followed him from the Ahl al-Ahwa. So are you saying the Ikhwan will follow the Dajjal? Are you saying the are you saying like the Awam from Ahl al-Sunnah will follow the Dajjal if you use this statement from Muhammad bin Sirin? Even go outside the Salafi circle. If a person disagreed with anyone from the Madkhali wizards or anyone else within the Madkhali sect, if they were inside the Salafi circle and they disagreed with Sheikh Rabi or disagreed amongst themselves, they're not even saved from being called people of desires or people of bid'ah. You understand what I mean? And you apply these statements that were originally designed, and when you obviously place them in his appropriate context, they were applied and they were designed and they were attributed to the original people of bid'ah. They were not Sunnis. They were not from Ahl Sunnah, from their asal, from the judur, from their roots. Anyway, let's carry on. This is 259. Okay? 259. And he mentions that an Awza'i and Yahya ibn Abi Kathir, that who said, if you meet a person of bid'ah on the road, then take another path. So are you going to now, let's just place a little example. If you see Ashari walking down the road now, okay? So just say you're in on Coventry Road, for example, and you're by Abu Zaid, okay? And you know you see one of the heads of the Asha'ira, are you going to cross the road and walk on the other side? Are you going to press the traffic light button and cross the road? Is that what you're going to do? Because that's what Yahya ibn Abi Kathir did. So again, are you going to follow the path of the Salaf and just say, oh, so hold on here. So let me pose a question now. As you can see on screen, you can see Ali Sheikh sitting next to Yusuf al-Qardawi. So he didn't take the statement of Yahya ibn Abi Kathir, because he's sitting right next to him. I think he should have been on the other side of the table. Or he should have went to another room and done a tele, you know, one of those video conferences. Skype, you know, Facebook Messenger, FaceTime, you know, whatever methods. Why was he sitting next to him? So is he a sahib al-bid'ah now? Yes. And if you look at the photo, you know, you can't really tell his emotions, but I can sense there's some, you know, a beautiful conversation happening here with sahib al-bid'ah. So, you know, what can you do? Oh, according to you. Let's carry on. 290, he says, وَكَانَ أَيُوبُ, that is Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani. He said that he used to name the people of Ahwa, meaning the people of desires, all of them as Khawarij. And he said that indeed the Khawarij, you see, Ahl al-Ahwa, and who were they? Al-Khawarij. So you see how you guys have abused the text. That the Khawarij, so he used to call all of the Ahl al-Ahwa Khawarij. Why? He said that the Khawarij used to differ in their names, because there were different groups of Khawarij, but they used to unite with the sword. So who, this Ahl al-Ahwa, who were they? Al-Khawarij. But you use that for Ahl al-Sunnah. As I said, Yusama'ish. Ahl al-Ahwa, Yusama'ish. Ahl al-Ahwa, kulluhum al-Khawarij. Wa kulluhum al-Khawarij. The statements from here, Ibana and Imam La'ika'i's book, Shar al-Usul al-I'tiqad Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, shows you that when you contextualize all of these statements, so as I said before, Kalimat al-Haq, Urid biha batil. That what they're saying is a statement of truth, but what they want from it is falsehood. So now let's go to another book and show you the reality of these statements that have been abused by the Al-Madaakhilah. You got the book here, Khalq al-Fa'al al-Ibad, wa Rad al-Jahmiyyah, wa Ashab al-Ta'til. This is a book by Imam al-Bukhari, okay? So as you can see on screen, he's got a narration. Imam Bukhari mentions that Abu Zakariya Yahya bin Yusuf al-Zammi, قال كنا عند عبد الله ابن إدريس. That this Abu Zakariya Yahya bin Yusuf al-Zimmi, he was with Abdullah bin Idris. And a man came and said, يا أبا محمد ما تقول في قوم يقولون القرآن مخلوق. He said, what do you say about a people that say that the Quran is مخلوق? فقال أمن اليهود. He says, are they from the Yahud? He says, no. قَالَ فَمَّنَ النَّصَارَى. Are they from the Nasara? He said, no. He said, are they from the Majus? He said, no. So he asked, who are they from? He said, are they from Ahl al-Tawheed? He said, yes. He said, they are not from Ahl al-Tawheed. لَيْسَ هَؤُلَى مِنْ أَهْلِ التَّوْحِيدِ. هَؤُلَى الزَّنَادِقَ. مَنْ زَعَمَ أَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ مَخْلُوقٌ فَقَدْ زَعَمَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَخْلُوقٌ. He said that they are not from the people of Tawheed. In fact, they are people of Zandaqa, or they are from the Zanadiqa. And whoever says that, you know, that the Quran's makhluk, that the Quran's created, فَعَلَيْهِ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ, and upon him is the curse of Allah. Do not sit with them and do not marry into them. So once again, the statement, do not sit with them. Look at the context. Look at the context. Let's now go to number 8. It says that وَقِيلَ لِأَبِي بَكْرِ بِنْ عَيَّاشِ إِنَّ قَوْمًا بِبَغْدَادِ يَقُولُونَ إِنَّهُ مَخْلُوقٌ. So he's talking about the Mu'tazila. And he said, وَيْلَكْ مَنْ قَالَ هَذَا. And then this Abi Bakr bin Ayyash or Ayyash said, وَيْلَكْ, woe to you, مَنْ قَالَ هَذَا, who says this, عَلَى مَنْ قَالَ الْقُرْآنَ مَخْلُوقٌ. And he said that whoever says that the Quran is makhluk, la'natullah, wa huwa kafir zindiq, that he is a kafir zindiq. And what does he say straight after? Do not sit with them. So after making takfir, what does he say? Do not sit with them. Isn't that your rhetoric? Those general statements that you use, do not sit with them. But when you apply his context, he's made takfir in the Mu'tazila. And then he says, don't sit next to them. So are you using these statements to promote it on Ahl Sunnah? And now, we got a statement from Sufyan al-Thawri. Okay, Sufyan al-Thawri. And he said, and Imam al-Bukhari is narrating this, by the way. So remember, it's Amir al-Mu'mineen fil Hadith. As you can see on screen, وقال الثوري من قال القرآن مخلوق فهو كافر. So whoever says the Quran is مخلوق, he is كافر. So again, the statement before says that whoever says the Quran مخلوق is a كافر, do not sit with them. Do not sit with them. People are desires. So you see the pattern. You see the pattern. How you really, really abused the statements of the Salaf. Now, you got a statement. Okay, he says وقيل لي حمد بن يوسف. It was said to Hamd bin Yusuf that I met a people, okay, and I heard from them that the Quran is makhluk. And he responded by saying, a shaitan has spoken this. Whoever speaks like this is a jahmi, and the jahmi are kafir. So remember, when Ibn Taymiyyah said, al jahmiya ittada'at, that they did a bid'ah. What bid'ah was this? This is bid'ah mukaffara. Because look, you got major imams of the Salaf calling him a kuffar. So when they said Ahl al-Ahwa, people of desires, people of misguidance that they regularly use, the Madaakhilah, can't use the Salaf. Because the Salaf are talking about bid'ah mukaffara. You guys are applying these statements on Muslims that disagree with you. So there you go again. Here you go. The books of the Salaf that you constantly quote and you constantly use against Ahl al-Sunnah. You know now the context. You know now the context that when it was applied by the Salaf, they were applying it on the foundations of Ahl al-Bidah. Meaning these guys were the root of Ahl al-Bidah. So you use these statements on who? I keep mentioning that, on who? Now again, the three to four wizards that you have, you know, Rabi' and Ubaid al-Jabri and all of these, you know, scholars of yours that use this and the chains of date, that if you sit next to this guy, you're from Ahl al-Bidah.
You said about the, be careful from making tabdi' on the awam. Give me an example. I make tabdi' on someone as Ami from Ahl al-Sunnah.
Behave.
People try to accuse others, say, in order for you to be Salafi, you have to go to Majid, you have to go to Spubs. In order for you to be Salafi, you have to go to Majid al-Sunnah. No, we don't say that, but we say, hold a minute, you claim it to be Salafi, and you live right next to Aston Majid, Majid Nabawi, but you don't go sit with the Prophet Salafiyun, and you go to Majid al-Bida. Abadan. There's not a big question mark on top of your head, every around your body.
Now again, what we're going to do now, we're going to call imams who understood the concept of bid'ah in its appropriate place and placed it, you know, placed it fairly and explained the context. So as you can see on screen, al-bid'ah is of two types. There's a small bid'ah, as you can see, and it mentions like the ghulu of the tashay'u. And it mentions that this ghulu, okay, was found in many of the tabi'een. This ghulu, this minor bid'ah, was found in many of the tabi'een. So you see, there's major bid'ah and there's minor bid'ah. You guys, absolute scumbags, when you use they from Ahl al-Bid'ah, don't sit next to them, you're placing us in the same category as al-Jahmiya, al-Mu'tazila, etc. Then he states, we'll just go next. Oh, then Imam al-Dahabi says, without stopping it, he said that despite the fact that they had religion and devotion and honesty, and if you were to reject those narrations from those people who had the minor bid'ah, then you'd be rejecting many of the narrations of the prophetic method, and this is a major catastrophe. Then Imam al-Dahbi said, then there's bid'atul kubra, the major bid'ah, okay, and this is like the rawafid in their ghulu. And that they curse Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma and make dua against them. This is a bid'ah, major bid'ah. You see, this is a major bid'ah. So Imam al-Dahabi explains this. Let's move on now. So you notice that the quotes that I've brought thus far shows how the Salaf was stern and severe against sitting with Ahl al-Bid'ah. Now the question we can pose now, if you can't sit next to them and you have to take the other road, so if you see them, you take the other road, so you got to cross the road and run. Okay, so again, to the Spubzla, if you see an Ashari walking on the road, make sure you cross the road, yeah? You know, if I see you, then you're from Ahl al-Bid'ah, because you're on the same side of the road. So as you can see on screen, you got the book, Sharh Sahih al-Bukhari, from Ibn Battal. And as you can see on screen, it says here, Listen to this. So we've presented, don't sit next to them, don't sit next to them. It says, وَاخْتَلَفَ الْعُلَمَاء فِي الصَّلَاةِ الْخَلْفَ الْخَوَارِجِ وَأَهْلِ الْبِدْعَةِ. That Ibn Battal says that the ulama had a difference of opinion of praying the salat behind the Khawarij and Ahl al-Bid'ah. Hold on here. You use those statements to say, don't sit next to Ahl al-Bid'ah. But the ulama had a difference of opinion by praying behind them. So, isn't prayer the most important pillar after the Shahada? And the ulama differed in praying behind the Khawarij and Ahl al-Bid'ah. What's going on here? And let's show you who prayed behind them, okay? As you can see on screen. That it's been narrated that Ibn Umar used to pray behind Hajjaj. And Ibn Abi Layla and Sa'id ibn Jubair used to also pray behind him. And then on top of that, they rebelled against him. And then he said, وَقَالَ الْحَسَنِ. This is Hassan al-Basri. He says, there is no harm for a believer to pray his salat behind the munafiq, according to Hassan al-Basri. And it states that the munafiq's prayer does not benefit praying behind a mu'min. You understand what I mean? So the prayer behind a munafiq, it doesn't harm the believer, but the munafiq praying behind a believer doesn't benefit him. And then he mentioned Ibrahim al-Naqai. He said that we used to pray behind the leaders, whoever they may be. And Abu Wa'il used to congregate with Mukhtar al-Thaqafi, the liar. Ja'far bin Burqan, he said, I asked Maymun bin Mahran, and praying behind a man that mentions that he's from the Khawarij. And he said, you don't pray to him, but you pray to Allah. And that we used to pray behind Hajjaj, and with us were Hururiya wa Azraqiya, meaning those major groups from the Khawarij. They used to be with us and we used to pray. Okay? Then he mentions that Shafi'i used to allow praying the Salat, even if it wasn't good in his religion. And then he continues, he says there's other groups that didn't like it, and Imam Malik never used to like it. But then at the bottom, it says, as you can see, it says, وَقَالَ الثَّوْرِ فِي الْقَدَرِيَّةِ. That authority used to say regarding the Qadariyah, do not approach him. So you heard the statement from Ibn Battal's Sharh of Sahih Bukhari. Now we got something interesting, okay? We got something interesting. You hear when you notice the Madaakhilah and their likes always point the finger at especially in our time, in our modern time, we hear this phenomenon. You're a Qutubi, you're an Ikhwani. You notice those statements that come out. So as you can see on screen, we've got a fatwa, okay, from the Lajna, from the Lajna, which is sort of the major sheikhs in Saudi that does research and fatwa. And it mentions under the question and fatwa number 6250, it mentions that the Lajna counted the Ikhwan al-Muslimun as part of Ahl Sunnah when he was asked a question, and even recommended cooperating with them in good and abstaining from their errors. The scholars who passed this ruling were Sheikh bin Baz, Allah yirhamu, Sheikh Abdullah Qu'ud, Sheikh Abdullah Ghudayan, and Sheikh Abdul Razzaq Afif. And you can see the statement as well, which is as part of the book. It states that when they were asked this question, he said, أَقْرَبَ الْجَمَاعَاتِ الْإِسْلَامِيَةِ إِلَى الْحَقِّ. And the closest true group to the truth who are enthusiastic are the Ahl al-Sunnah, are the Ahl al-Hadith, wa Jama'at al-Ansar al-Sunnah. And then he said, Thumma Ikhwan al-Muslimun. So this is also from the Lajna of Saudi Arabia. So hold on here, what happened there? So as you can see on the screen, the fatwa number, okay, 6280, okay, it mentions that the Lajna acknowledges that the Salafis, the Ikhwan al-Muslimun, are all sects on which they are both good and bad can be found in them, and therefore recommended cooperation with them in good and advising them regarding their errors. And this scholar and the scholars who passed this ruling were also Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, Sheikh Abdullah Qu'ud, Sheikh Abdullah Ghudayan, and Sheikh Abdul Razak Afif. Okay, so quite clear you can see that cooperate in good, unite in good, and do not unite in aggression and in sin. So They are part of Ahl-Sunnah. Remember, Ikhwan al-Muslimun is a political movement. It's a political movement that started after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire by Hassan al-Banna. That over time is evolved, but it's still a political group. It's not one of the 73 sects as you guys make it out to be. And Sheikh bin Baz, if they, Allah rahmatullahi, and the Lajna, meaning the committee members of the senior Saudi scholars, why did they say the closest group to Ahl-Sunnah, Ahl-Hadith, and then Ansar al-Sharia, and then Ikhwan al-Muslimun? Ain't they from Ahl-Bid'ah?
For example, if you see someone who is a Salafi, even though this is very hard to imagine, well, let's say the Salafi comes along and all of a sudden one day he says, well, actually I think Al-Ikhwan, they're doing a good job. or I think Hassan al-Banna had some good ideas, or had some good, in him. Anyone who comes out and makes this type of remark, automatically this man is mubtada. Because the issue is absolutely clear, because the hujjah has been established and it is known, it is widespread, and there's no confusion in this issue at all.
What happened there? You understand what I mean? So are you going to now justify this fatwa now? And say, no, but this was before. Well, what do you mean before? You guys treat Ikhwan al-Muslimin worse than you do the Khawarij. Honestly. I'll be honest with you, it's ridiculous. Okay, let's carry on. Okay. Subhanallah al-Azim. You notice, that they have videos regarding backbiting Ahl al-Bid'ah. Okay, backbiting Ahl al-Bid'ah. It's permissible to backbite Ahl al-Bid'ah. Okay, so remember who they were talking about. Okay, remember, I keep referring to that. I keep reiterating that point. Ahl al-Bid'ah were the major Ahl al-Bid'ah at that time, and how you've placed it, those rulings upon us. So, as you can see on screen, you got the book, Al-Ghiba wa Namima. Okay, and this is by Ibn Abi Dunya. And as you can see on screen, there's a fatwa by Ibrahim al-Nakhai. Okay, Ibrahim al-Nakhai. And he says, there's no ghiba of a person of bid'ah. Okay, there's no ghiba of a person of bid'ah. Imam that is a tyrant, the mubtadi'ah, and the fasiq, that they, if you talk about them, it doesn't count as bid'ah. And Hassan al-Basri says that there is no ghiba when you talk behind a mubtadi'ah's back. So if you talk behind a mubtadi'ah's back, there's no ghiba. And you notice the Madaakhilah use these statements. They say, the Salaf said that there's no ghiba behind when you talk behind Ahl al-Bid'ah.
So backbiting, my brother, is haram, but there is some situation when it is halal.
And they apply this to, the ones they disagree with. Even amongst the Salafis, they also could talk behind their back and say, no, but the Salaf said, if you talk behind Ahl al-Bid'ah, then it's okay. There's no Bid'ah. But remember, these are statements of men. Remember that. As much as we revere them, they're still men. They're not infallible. Remember that. So let's continue on. So you got a statement here from Zaida bin Qudama, and it said to Mansur bin Mu'tamar that if I was fasting, is it allowed for me to degrade and belittle the Sultan? He said no. So I said to him, can I degrade and belittle Ahl al-Ahwa, the people of desires? He said yes. Okay, so now let's see how Imam Nawawi explained what the conditions of backbiting, which when it becomes permissible. Backbiting can only become permissible in certain conditions. As you can see, I've got Al-Athqar by Imam al-Nawawi, and as you can see on screen, Imam al-Nawawi explains, it's under the chapter of Bab al-Bayan, Ma yubahu min al-ghiba, that when it becomes recommended to do ghiba. And the first one is when it's oppression. So it mentions that it's permissible for one who is oppressed to complain about a situation to the ruler or to a judge about someone who holds authority or has the ability to grant him justice against the oppressor. Okay, so he says something along the lines that, this person's oppressed me, this person has done this and this. So, and al-fulan ظلمني وفعل بي كذا وأخذ لي كذا ونحو ذلك. So he can do that. And then the other is seeking assistance in changing an evil and in returning a sinner back to what is correct. So you can see that number two. It mentions warning and advising Muslims against the evil. And this is what the Madkhalis abuse. Okay, warning and advising the Muslim against evil. And Imam al-Nawawi says there are several perspectives to this, of which is declaring someone unreliable in the field of narrating hadith and giving testimony. So this is talking about muhaddithun, and others like them. This is permissible to do according to the consensus of the Muslims. Rather, it becomes obligatory to its necessity, and then it carries on. So you got this book here, Al-Athqar by Imam al-Nawawi. I don't want to go through all six, but it just shows the conditions of when they take these statements of the Salaf, they don't know the conditions. And Imam al-Nawawi confirms the conditions and when it becomes permissible, not like the Madaakhilah who just take the statements, oh, we like to talk behind Ahl al-Bid'ah, and obviously ply on Muslims and think they got a God-given right now. Even Ghiba now would become permissible for them. Go figure. Okay. Now we got an important book that I want to address. And basically, as you can see on screen, this is written by Abdul Muhsin bin Abbad. Okay, and this is called Rifqan li Ahli Sunnah bil Ahli Sunnah. Okay, so this book is basically called that being gentle to Ahli Sunnah. And this book was written, okay, by the teacher of Sheikh Rabi'. Okay, it was written by the teacher of Sheikh Rabi'. Okay, so let's just skip through these chapters. This chapter is the position of Ahli Sunnah that from an alim that makes a mistake and is excused, and you don't make tabdi' on him, of the fitna of those who, you know, cast out people from Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah, okay, in this era. And then look at this chapter here. He says that there are people who test people with people. You know, like the Madkhalis. So for example, the Madaakhilah will say, what do you think of Sheikh Rabi'? And they'll say, what do you think of Sheikh Rabi'? And this Sheikh and that Sheikh. And if you say, well, I don't take from him, they base it in that regard.
So now, when we talk about this time, they say, why does the brother mention Sheikh Rabi', Sheikh Rabi', Sheikh Rabi'? Because Sheikh Rabi' is that man in this time, ya ikhwan. You ask any of them, all of Ahlul Bid'ah, they hate Rabi' al-Madkhali. They hate him, ya ikhwan. So therefore, he has become a test for the people of bid'ah and desires. So those who come to us, then yes, we test him with Sheikh Rabi'. And we can test him with others. When we see from them some mukhalafat, or we see from them shubahat, then we test them with the ulama. We test them with Muqbil bin Hadi. We test them with Al-Albani. And we test them with Rabi' al-Madkhali.
Then Sheikh Abdul Muhsin al-Abbad says that if it's more of a right and better that if you're going to test people, and why don't you test them with our Sheikh bin Baz? If you're going to test people with anyone, you know, if they're using that example, why are you going to Sheikh Rabi' and various others? So in this page here, he mentions about certain students of his, says, and who attended his lessons. Okay, and as you can see on screen, he doesn't mention the names, he just mentions when they graduated. Okay, so you got two of the people here, and then in the next page, as you can see, he's got another student that he mentions, and the majority of the scholars says that there's a few of the sheikhs that he says at the bottom of the footnotes that ثَلَاثَةَ الَّذِينَ شَارِكُوا لِلْتَلْمِيدِ الْجَارِيَ فِي اِعْتِرَاد عَلَى الرِّسَالَةِ. So one of those students of Sheikh Abdul Muhsin bin Abbad, Sheikh Rabi'. Okay, so this is exactly who he was referring to. Now, promoted. He mentioned that those who innovate in Medina. So how he applied this generally to the Ummah, whereas this hadith was talking about in Medina, whoever innovates in Medina. And he cut and pasted the part where he goes, Allah's curse be upon him, the angels and all of mankind. And the hadith was talking about those who innovate in Medina. Allah's curse be upon him and the angels of all of mankind. So this is the end of the video. I know it's lengthy, and I know it's hard to digest, and some people might not get the full essence of this video. But the reality is that there's a very, very big problem and an underlying problem with the Madaakhilah, with their cultish behavior, which we need to call out. And we're not going to stop in calling this out. Believe you me, when the Madaakhilah quote a reference or they promote a video from Shamsi and his likes, they would need to be very, 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 very careful in what they say and make sure it's watertight. Because when bro Hajji listens to it and he finds any little dodgy little technicality or a half-baked quote from your mouth or some verbal diarrhea coming from your mouth, bro Hajji will expose you. Remember that. And you've got someone who is quite rigorous in how he dissects videos. So be warned, be warned, and be warned. So that's it for today. Make dua for me, support the channel, and don't forget, if there's any mistakes that have come from me, then know this is from me and Shaitan, and forgive me and send me a message to highlight my error, and I'll obviously you know, acknowledge it and retract it if you know, it's a major one. And anything that I've said good is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we seek his pleasure and we seek his benefit. We have to rectify our intention. At the end of the day, it's all for his sake. No deed is worth doing unless it's done with full sincerity. At the end of the day, we could do 1,000 good deeds. If it's not done with pure ikhlas and a correct intention, wallah al-azim, that deed is fruitless. That deed
is fruitless. It's got no benefit. So make dua for me. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rectify my intentions, to make me sincere, to make me humble, and accept this from me. So make dua for us. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad.
طير أغناها وقد جابت سما كم مرة قد ضقت من عظم البلاء بشر وشيطان يحاصرني أبا كم مرة قد أظلم الدرب